Hi, my name is Dr. Anita Bandrowski, and I'm here talking to you today about the Rigor and Transparency Index and this new paper in the Journal of Internet Medical Research. I'm here with one of my co-authors, Dr. Rulatsu.
Yeah, my name is Martijn Rulatsu. I'm indeed one of the co-authors, and we're going to talk a little bit about the findings of this paper and what we think is the most interesting part, maybe some concluding remarks and calls to action. So looking at the paper, Anita, to you, what was most notable and challenging?
I think the most notable is that, you know, we've really expanded looking for different kinds of rigor criteria across the entirety of the biomedical literature. In fact, we're looking at a lot of data. We're looking at protocols now. We're looking at code. And it's really quite surprising at how little, for example, how few protocols there are available in the scientific literature. We've had a lot of growth in the last few years, but I feel like a lot of those pieces are still lacking. I think the most notable is that things are improving. And right behind me back here is a map of the world, which shows the Rigor and Transparency Index as it breaks down by different countries. So, you know, what we did is we looked over the last 10 years to see, you know, which countries were moving ahead with increased rigor and transparency criteria reporting and which were kind of still behind. So I hope that you can see your favorite country there. Let me get out of Australia here and China. And you can see those pieces move along as well. This is a figure that's available as a supplemental file in the paper. Martijn, what did you find most interesting?
Well, I think what was interesting in the paper is that we've been able to actually show that if you provide more information around papers, that the score goes up. Now that is sort of intuitively, but we were able to use a data set created by the Center for Open Science. And so they took a couple of papers in cancer research. And you see that also behind me. I'm a bit more in the way than Anita, but so the initial study, as you can see, the reproducibility score was fairly low, between 2 and 4, let's say 3. Then the registered report, which is already an improvement, had a higher score. And finally, reproduced study had way higher score. This was the main reason for that, of course, is that they provided a lot more information about the resources that they used. But we also looked at institutions. And it's quite interesting. You would think, actually, if you look at the name of institutions, then you would be inclined to compare institutions like for like with the same name. However, that is not always the case. And if you've been in research like myself, you know that each department has its own research focus and that the actual place within the university can differ very much. And so what we did is that we took papers that are comparable areas and then grouped it with similar papers in other departments. And so you could have papers in internal medicine department that have like for like with cell biology department, which you wouldn't naturally do. But based on what they have published, we could show that actually they are very comparable. And then you can compare them. Okay, how do they differ in reproducibility and rigor standards?
What's really interesting about that is it also gets you around these centers. So a lot of times there's a center for a particular type of science, which does a very similar thing to, say, a department of neuropsychology or some such. And that kind of gets you out of that need to have comparison just based on the name. So I thought that was a very interesting piece of work done by one of our co-authors, Mr. Peter Ekman, who did this whole analysis on the departments and combined them with the ROR data, ROR.org, for those of you who are interested, to put the departments into the universities from which they come from and doing that in a very standardized way. So I think that's about what we have in terms of the most notable bits and pieces of this paper. I think it's an interesting read, certainly. As you can see, you know, the map of the world behind me, it gets more and more blue, going from about an average of 3 out of 10 score to over 4 out of 10 score from 2010 to 2020. And I think that's happening over the entire world. Some countries are a little bit ahead, some countries are behind. For example, here, Ethiopia and Norway are really far ahead, as is Iceland. So it's been kind of a fun way to look at this data, and we certainly hope that we've convinced you to take a look at the paper.
What would you like others to pick up from this and take further?
I think that, you know, it's really interesting, I think, for people to be able to look at not just their favorite journal over the last 10 years and how well they're doing in terms of their Rigor and Transparency Index, but also their favorite institutions. And I think one of the things that we found in our previous work is that when journals do a really good job trying to convince authors that they will need to improve their rigor and reproducibility addressment in a particular journal, then the authors respond and they tend to do much, much better at addressing the various rigor criteria. And I think the same is true for a lot of institutions and indeed countries. For example, the United Kingdom has really attempted to improve how well their researchers address reproducibility issues within their manuscripts. And you can kind of see that they're sort of at the leading edge of honors that we've measured. So their institutions tend to be a bit better, with others perhaps not quite as good. So I think if we can convince institutions to pay attention to rigor and reproducibility criteria and looking into those as a part of their everyday research process, I think we would be really happy.
And how can institutions do that? Suppose I'm a naive researcher. I've never heard of this publication, but I like the thought. Where can I start?
Well, one thing that's really easy to do is just to go to sciscore.com, and you can run your own paper through or your own papers through some free tokens that every researcher will get as long as they log in with their ORCID ID to the tool. And so anyone can improve their own paper if they wish to, or check how the tool does. If you are work submitting to a participating journal, the tool will also be run on your paper directly. And whether that's something that you do yourself and then work with the report to improve your paper, or if that's something that the editor does, this is something that is happening already with at least some journals. And, you know, we hope you use the report to improve manuscripts and find those places where there might be some errors of omission. Hopefully we've convinced individual authors to go to sciscore.com and run their own papers. And we've hopefully convinced some institutions to take a look at their policies regarding rigor and reproducibility and how their researchers are publishing with full knowledge of these kind of criteria.
I think as well, we also look forward to any feedback on this paper. We're curious to hear what people out there think of our latest publication, and we look forward to engaging with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.